Why does Christianity change the truth? God's word into a lie. Example. Romans 6, verse 17.
But thanks be to God that you who were once slaves of sin have become obedient.
Christianity says it one way. But the original Greek says it another.
Cherish be to God.
That you who were once slaves of sin have become obedient from the heart.
But thanks be to God is in almost all English translations. However, the Greek does not say thanks, Eucharistio, be to God. It says, but Eucharis be to God. Why? If God meant thanks, then why didn't he use the Greek Eucharistio? Christeo Theo. Grace, yet to the God. Stephanus, 1550, Textus Receptus. Christeo Theo. Scribner, 1894, Textus Receptus. Christeo Theo. Byzantine Majority, Christeo Theo. Alexandria, Christeo Theo. Court in Westcott, Christeo Theo. Christianity universally translates the Greek charis to the English grace. And define grace as undeserved, unmerited, unearned favor of God freely given to man. Why does Christianity change God's intent from charis, unmerited favor, to Eucharistia, thanks? Why? Dictionary.com translator. Thanks is translated into Greek as Eucharistia. Unmerited, undeserved, unearned favor from man to God, from man to God, yet but grace be to God, yet but grace be to God. Does God need unmerited favor from us? Romans 6:17. But God be thanked, grace, that ye were the servants of sin, but ye have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which is delivered to you. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 57. But thanks, grace be to God, which giveth us the victory through the Lord Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians 2:14. Now thanks, grace be unto God, which always causes us to triumph in Christ and makes manifest the savor of his knowledge by us in every place. Does Almighty God need unmerited favor from sinners or saints? Yes. Thanks be, grace reads more literally, grace to God. Why not be consistent? Why not? But thanks be to God. Why not leave it as it is and see what Paul means? Latin Vulgate. Gradius autem deo. Why alter it to fit our theology and traditions? Why does Christianity change God's intent from charis, unmerited favor, to Eucharistia, thanks? Why? grace be to God. Does God need unmerited favor from us? Romans 6:17. But God be thanked, Greece, that you were the servants of sin, but you have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which is delivered to you. 1 Corinthians 15:57. But thanks, grace be to God, which giveth us the victory through the Lord Jesus Christ. Does Almighty God need unmerited favor from sinners or saints? Yes. Thanks be, Kyrios reads more literally, grace to God. Why not be consistent? Why not? But thanks be to God. Why not leave it as it is and see what Paul means? Latin Vulgate, gratias autem deo. Why alter it to fit our theology? Why did Christianity alter it to change, thus saith the Lord? How to judge the correctness of a definition? 1. Substitute the definition for term in the sentence verse where the term is found. 2. Do it for all occurrences of the term in all the verses. Let's try it for James 4, verse 6. God resists the proud but gives grace to the humble. Unmerited favor does not make sense here. If it is unmerited favor, then the proud should have it too. In fact, the proud is more unmerited to receive it. This is exactly like what Paul says in Romans 6, verse 1b. Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Let's try. Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Let's try for Romans 6:17. Plug in grace. Grace is grace according to Christianity. Quote, yet grace, that is unmerited favor, be to the God. But grace does not make sense because God is deserving and merits worth, honor, thanksgiving, love, obedience, etc. of mankind. Dr. Donald Hubbard nicely sums up grace, mercy, peace, writing that, quote, grace is for the worthless. It is God giving me what I don't deserve. To avoid an absurd blunder as to how Paul command men give to God what God doesn't deserve, that is grace, they had to do something to cover their butts, to save face, and to save something else. What could that be? Many today have a false view of grace, Greek charis. To them, grace in the New Testament means unmerited favor. It does mean favor, but they add the word unmerited to it in order to uphold heresies like unconditional eternal security and other errors. Let us look at how the word is used in Scripture, as it becomes readily apparent that such a definition is nonsensical. If grace, charis, is unmerited favor like most theologians and preachers like to suggest, then how did Jesus grow it? Luke 2:52. And Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor, charis, with God and man. Thanks? And Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in thanks with God and man? Go ahead, try replacing grace with thanks or unmerited favor everywhere grace is found in the English Bible. For example, Ephesians 2, verse 8. Thank you. interesting aspect of this word is that it too has a root word that it comes from. Kara comes from the word kero, which is defined as one, to rejoice, be glad. Two, to rejoice exceedingly. Three, to be well, thrive. Four, in salutations, hail, at the beginning of letters, to give one greeting, salute. This word, kero, can be found in this passage. Philippians 4:4. Rejoice, kero, in the Lord always. And again I say, rejoice, kero. So what does all of this mean? Well, any discussion about grace has to take into consideration the fact that whatever the meaning of grace is, its very foundation is built upon the nature of joy and rejoicing. That means that there is a nature of pleasure associated with whatever grace means, and this pleasure is expressive in a positive manner. Consider that when you begin to smell, you may actually be moving into the realm of grace more than you realize. The Old Testament clearly states that, quote, joy of the Lord is your strength, unquote. Now we can say that the foundation of grace, joy, is your strength. So where is this leading us?
A letter of Jude, chapter 1, to the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints.
Luke 12, verses 31 through 32, quote, but rather seek ye the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom, unquote. From this point forward, we are going to look at grace and the kingdom of the mind that has been renewed in the nature of joy. Why and how does God receive grace? Answer, read on to verse 22. But joy, pleasure, delight be to God.
Charis be to God. That you who were once slaves of sin have become obedient from the heart to the standard of teaching to which you were committed, and, having been set free from sin, have become slaves of righteousness, and have become slaves of God, the fruit you get leads to sanctification and its end, eternal life. Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that I had lost. Just so, I tell you, there is joy before the angels of God over one sinner who repents.
Repent and turn from all your transgressions, lest iniquity be your ruin. Cast away from you all the transgressions that you have committed, for I have no pleasure in the death of anyone, declares the Lord God. So turn, and live.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased. And a voice came from heaven,
you are my beloved Son, with you I am well pleased. Behold my servant, whom I uphold, my chosen, in whom my soul delights.
His master said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little, I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full. Looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God.